You're watching Suck Professor. Hello, everybody. It's me, Hank. I'm joined by...
James!
Hello. Game of Thrones, Season 6, Episode 4, Book of the Stranger. And what a book it was. I'd like to read it again. James, exciting day here in Game of Thrones Fanville, huh?
Very, yes.
How did you feel about it?
I thought it was...
All right, let's get to the action. So let's start it out here. We go in with Longclaw right up there. Pretty sword, nice handle. Man walks up, grabs it. And we were thinking, by the way, we're like, oh, he left it behind?
Right, because it was given to him by the previous Lord Commander, so maybe he thought it belonged to the Night's Watch, that it should stay at Castle Black, but...
Or that, because in the last episode, Jon Snow, I get you and Jon Snow confused.
Yeah, we're very similar.
Yeah, you're both very handsome and popular with the ladies. Wink, wink, teenage girls. he walked out. He goes, my watch is ended. And then he's like strutting out like a surly teen.
He meant his Apple Watch. He was going to get it fixed.
Yeah. Well, you know, he had a Fitbit and he needed to get to 10,000 steps. So anyway, we come in. This guy picks up his sword. He's like, where are you going to go, man? And he's like, oh, I'm going to travel. I got to, you know, pack up my stuff. So there what does he ask him? Where's he going to go?
Oh, he just says south.
South.
Yeah.
Right. But he's not. Yeah. I feel. What else happened in this scene here? I feel like I'm missing something.
Well, he says you can't leave at this time. You saw what was behind the wall. You saw what the White Walkers did.
Right.
You can't abandon us at this point in time. And he was saying, my brothers in the wall killed me. I can't stay here with them.
Yes, right. And then we hear a horn or something like, oh, someone's at the door. So they all run out. We cut to an outside shot and the door opens. No way!
Yeah, this shocked the heck out of me because, as we know from Game of Thrones, whenever two characters come into meeting one another from after a long period of separation, either one of them gets killed or one of them gets torn away, or they see each other but they don't actually get to connect. This is a rare moment in Game of Thrones where they actually do reunite.
Yes, George Railroad Martin is an evil guy. He balances the universe by murdering people we love. Hopefully that doesn't happen because Sansa is back with Brienne and Podrick.
And more freaky for the people in the tower, in the
Castle Black.
Castle Black is there's two women coming in.
Yes.
So they're not used to that either.
Yes. Boy, I can, as I've been a man since I was a baby, and I can say the presence of a woman is an arousing factor. So, by the way, speaking of that, look at her sword. This is the sword that Jaime Lannister gave
her. That's true. So there's two Valyrian steel swords in the one place at the same time.
Notice it's got the head of a lion, similar to the Longclaw blade. Let's kick this quickly. Oh, got this mouse.
Well, Longclaw's got the wolf, right?
Oh, yeah. Well, that's what I meant. Similar in design, like a feature, like Pez dispensers. You know, they kind of have different heads. So, okay, get back to Brienne here. We're jumping ahead. And I took so many screenshots. So here we go. I love these three. Anyway, my heart swelled with joy watching Sansa come here. We all knew that this was a long time coming. Well, we weren't sure. I was hoping. And man, the Stark kids, finally someone's having a nice moment. And for her especially, she's been in a nightmare.
But she's not actually riding into a place that she feels comfortable, because bear in mind, her favorite person in the world was Renly Baratheon, who she swore.
Wait, you're talking about Brienne.
Brienne,
I'm talking about Sansa.
Sansa, okay, she loved Renly too. No, she didn't.
Yeah. But no, but she could use a hug from a family member.
Yes, she's had a pretty bad time.
Yeah, and then this guy's like, I'd like to hug all of you, even Podrick. So anyway, great moment though, man. I was so happy. They're all a little freaked out. They're road weary. And then here's the shot. Oh, yes, my dead heart is awakening, James. I'm reliving this. And he's even got his hair back in a bit of a man bun.
Well, he had his hair cut as well.
Oh, yeah, that's right. The red woman also is a salonist. So she came over. By the way, not a man bun. I know they're on top. Ponytails are in the back.
Yep.
Okay. So they see each other. They can't believe it. Oh, my God. Is it really you? Yes, it's really me. Oh, let's hug. Okay. So they hug, man. Ugh. Nice.
The whole time they were doing that, I was thinking, is her cloak still sogging wet from that cold water? Because I would have just backed off.
James has been very worried about that.
That is the worst feeling.
The stream crossing. Yeah. Well, you know, James, movie magic is that hypothermia is not a thing. The clothes dry off much faster in imagination land. Just ask Willy Wonka when he pisses his pants. So what a moment, man. Oh, so nice. Of course, this red guy is like, whoa, it's like a whole head's a beard. So, There they are. I took a lot. Okay, now they're inside. She's got a bowl of ramen noodles, maybe some pho, and let me get the mouse out of the way. Sorry there. And, I'm so happy about it.
Well, something happened here that kind of confused me, though, because she says something along the lines of, where will we go? What will we do? And
no, she first says, "Where will you go?"
Right, and then it turned into the, you know, "You're my protector. My, yeah, he goes, your father's ghost would haunt me forever if I didn't continue to protect you.
I'll go wherever you go."
But he says something to the effect of, "I can't stay here, not after what happened."
Yeah.
Did he tell her what happened?
Why? Well, because
she doesn't ask further about it.
You're right. So you're saying, does she know that he is a zombie?
Yes.
Yeah.
They don't talk about it, but he does drop that one line that makes it seem as though they had that discussion, but she doesn't seem to be fazed by it.
True. You know, I mean, shit, she's seen a lot. Maybe, you know? Maybe she just rolls with it. Like,
yeah.
By the way, I'm a zombie dead back from the dead. I'm a dead. And she's like, oh, Jesus, these guys. More men in their fucking weird magic. Yeah, it's kind of a crazy moment, though. This is the part where he's like, the ghost would kill me. Oh, yeah, she takes the thing out of his hand. Yep. But not takes it, but she, mm-hmm. you know, he offers it. And she reaches, he offers, and she chokes on it, and then he laughs because they can't make good ale.
Ugh, gross! A rare lighthearted moment with Jon Snow and Sansa. You don't get that very often.
Not very much, no. No, I see spinoff in the works. Also, it's NyQuil. Mm-hmm. He is a NyQuil addict. So, DayQuil, actually, to keep him alive. you're right, because that's a crazy... I didn't think about that, had he told her. Interesting. Interesting, James. Let's keep going, though. We want to get through this. We hope these don't get too long.
Yep.
So,
So at this point, she's trying to bolster his will to leave the Castle Black to go after Winterfell, back the home.
She's already... Yeah, she brought that up right away, though. She's right. Like, we got to go get this fucking Ramsay,
yeah.
This piece of shit who has our house. And we got to go take... And he's like, ooh.
Yeah, he's... I've done enough fighting. I don't want to fight. Ever since I left Winterfell, I've been doing nothing but fighting. He's not really into the idea.
Yeah, he goes, I killed crows. I killed wildlings. I hung a boy younger than Bran. I've had diarrhea since I left. So she's like, I don't give a shit about your fucking diarrhea. We gotta go kill a guy who hurt me. So anyway, he's not quite on board with her yet. So, meaning going to Winterfell. But they're obviously having a nice night. Davos comes up to the Red Lady. She is just hanging around. He's like, what are you gonna be doing here, Red Lady? Wow, my Davos is really falling out of practice. And she's like, I'm going with Jon Snow. He goes, I thought Sannis was your boy. She's like, nah, I like Jon Snow, right? What else am I missing?
Well, that was pretty much what happened there. And then Brienne approaches not long thereafter and fills them in on
as events. They're standing down lower. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So the Red Woman walks away. Now they're hanging out down below. And Brienne comes up and just gives them the business. Brienne comes up and goes,
right.
Sup, bitches?
Right, because these are two of Brienne's least favorite people in the world because of, like I mentioned before, Renly Baratheon, the murderer from the Shadow Creature that was the spawn of her.
Yeah.
And
but does she have a specific... hatred of Davos, other than knowing that he was loyal to
that he was connected Stannis. To Stannis? I don't think so. I know they met before, which she says, but I think that was in the context that he was one of Stannis's men.
Yeah, and she came by, though. She's like, yeah, I was in the room when that scary ghost Stannis killed my one and true love, Renly. I was his Kingsguard, and you better keep a fucking third eye on you dumb red bitch.
Yeah,
so this was pretty intense.
She comes by in the most threatening way possible.
They also chose a camera angle. This woman, in real life, this is not some Tom Cruise
magic. No, she's huge.
Where they make a 5 foot man look like he's 5 foot ten. She's as big as me.
Yeah.
I'm 6'3", you know, and she's probably got slightly better calf muscles than I do, though. this shot here, I was like, whoa. So this is kind of a weird moment. And then she just gives him, moves in on his space to intimidate him some more because she could fuck them both up. Poor Red Woman. I didn't really have much to say to her, though.
No.
Right? They were just like, oh, all right, you crazy bitch. Thanks for coming by. Nice of you to be friendly. Oh, no, Davos is like, oh, it's in the past.
Oh, and she said she doesn't forgive, she doesn't forget.
Yeah, something like that. Yeah, she holds off, though, and then she just walks off. Cut to...
Robin
Arryn, the wacky little titty sucker from season 1 or 2 or 3 or 4 or 5. You know, the...
Throw him through the moon door. Yes. I want to see him fly.
One of my favorite characters. Makes me uncomfortable. If I knew this kid when I was a kid, I probably would have been uncomfortable too. Because fuck little wackos like this guy. But he's great for the show because it's one of those things where they show how lineage, the way power was passed down through. You know, sometimes you got a capable nice guy like Tommen. Capable, maybe not, but nice. You get a Joffrey, you get a kook like Robin with his wacko mom, and you get like a Ned Stark, and you get a Robb Stark. You get a good dude like Robb. You get the roll of the dice is what I mean. Okay. The luck of getting a wacko in charge. Anyway, he sucks at archery.
at most things.
Needs to get himself an HTC Vive and play a little with the arrows. And so this guy is, what's he saying here? He's, I don't know, saying some shit to him.
Yeah, this is basically where we see Littlefinger come in and...
Well, we know that, yeah. So now Littlefinger rolls up, and we haven't seen him much this season, I don't think at all. Hello, it's me, the mayor of Baltimore. He steps out. He goes, Uncle. He goes, hello, Robin. And then he goes, I have a present for you. Look!
It's a chicken.
A Harry Potter owl. You may now get mail. He goes, I brought you a falcon. It is the best falcon. By the way, check out this cool little stick it's standing on.
Oh, yeah, it's pretty fancy.
Made for falcon feet. Wow, the stick I sleep on is made for human feet. So he's all excited because that's a cool gift, man. Yeah. That's like giving a kid a Game Boy or something, you know?
And so while the kid's distracted, he lets loose his power play.
Yes, he pulls a little one of these politics smart guy moves and buys the favor of the kid first and then starts giving this dude the business. And he goes, we were attacked on the road and I only told one person where we were going and it was you, you fat weird guy with this who looks like your head is sticking out of the bottom of a coffee can.
But to be fair, I don't think he was telling the full truth there because he essentially handed Sansa over to Ramsay, right?
Yeah.
That was his whole plan from the get-go, and now he's changing his story, talking here, saying that he was accosted on the road and Sansa was taken by Bolton's men.
Yeah, I'm so glad that you're here, James, because I am too stupid to remember that stuff. Good call. Good catch. Yes. What an asshole.
What's his plan, though? What stake does he have in this race?
Right, in this moment, he wants to influence Robin.
Right.
But you're saying, why is he trying to get... So let's ask that at the end of what happens here. So he says that we got to do something with this guy here because he's causing trouble. And so we have this tense moment where Robin decides not to kill him.
Right.
And, you know, he's like, don't kill him. And then, I don't know why that's a great shot. And so then he goes, well, now we got to decide what to do. We got to go north. Let's organize the Vale. Right.
Right.
I know I'm getting it.
Well,
kind of wrong.
He mentions that Sansa's word has gotten out that Sansa's escaped from Ramsay Bolton, mm-hmm. and that she's heading north to the Wall to reunite with Rob, and that they need to go.
Jon Snow. Yeah,
and that they need to march on Winterfell. They need to help Sansa. They need to save her, protect her,
and help out the Stark kids.
Right.
Okay.
So why? What does he have to gain from forcing the armies of the Vale onto Winterfell against the Boltons?
Well, he gets Robin to agree. So that's what's mm-hmm. going to happen.
Right.
Because that's what he. So basically, Littlefinger gets what he wants. So what does he have to gain from that? I don't know. Maybe this guy's trying. I think he's the one pulling all the strings behind the scenes because mm-hmm. he's such a liar and a conniver. Because he went out of his way to get rid of Sansa to Ramsay, and now he's going to go after Ramsay. But I think he's just adapting to the change in conditions. I mean, maybe this is something people can weigh in the comments, because I'm not sure. I'm too stupid to figure it out. Yeah. What do you think?
It makes me wonder if Sansa and Littlefinger come together once more. Is he going to be a villain in her eyes after what she went through at his suggestion?
Yeah. I don't know. Maybe so. Could be. Yeah, there's probably a lot more to be said about that. We should let us know what you guys think. Why is Littlefinger? What's he up to? What's this guy up to? And is he really Littlefinger, or maybe it's medium-sized finger? So he gets Robin, and Robin's like, all right, yeah, we'll go kill them all. It's Sunday nights. He goes, all right, let's get the nights going. People texting me. God damn it! No one texted me all week, and now it's during this. So now, bam! What is this boat? Look at this. We got a mermaid with wings chained up. This looks like that thing at the top of the marine pyramid
temple,
that they knocked over. But sort of, but okay. So we know we're in marine. Here's my favorite four city councilmen.
And woman. And eunuch.
City council persons.
It's actually 3.5.
Yeah. Look, James. Slice! Okay, sorry, that was... all right, sorry, Varys. My God, enough. What are they talking about?
Oh, well, this is where they end up going back to congregate together.
Yeah.
To talk about what the future plan is going to be for the city in terms of the peace talks with the masters of the surrounding cities.
Yeah.
So, okay. Yeah, they're basically at this point saying that we want to negotiate with them, whereas they're saying, how long is it that you were a slave? What do you know of being a slave?
Yeah.
You don't know these people. Right. You can't possibly negotiate peace with them.
Yeah. He goes, I was a slave for a while. I know what it's like. And she goes, how long? He goes, long enough. And she goes, long enough to know, not to understand.
Right. So,
yeah.
So he, Tyrion is a master politician, a mm-hmm. master manipulator in terms of getting what he wants and appeasing the masses. But he's kind of out of his element here. He doesn't really fully understand the politics that are surrounding him.
True, yes. He has assumed a leadership role, though, meaning like he's kind of running, just symbolized by him being in front, you know what I mean? Like yeah. he's sort of, and then he's sitting in the little throne, you mm-hmm. know, and he's sort of, that's later on. We wouldn't call it a throne, but you know.
High chair.
It's a high chair. We could both make terrible jokes right now. So, and they're following in, but they're mm-hmm. still, they're not real thrilled with the way he's handling things around here. So they now we have this meeting James referred to with the nearby slave owners. So these guys, this guy comes in, we recognize, I think we've seen this guy before too, right? He comes in.
I think we've seen all of them before.
Yeah, we definitely have seen this guy here. Yeah. He approached Dany when she offered her gold. And when the dragons were small and they scared him off, and you know she, you know he was really shitty to her, and she kept mm-hmm. up his chest of gold, but she didn't kill him.
Right?
Could have. And Dario probably. I think there was Dario was around during that mm-hmm. scene, and so that was like season 4 or 5. I don't know. I get him confused. So anyway, the gist of this scene is that Tyrion offers these guys a compromise. They're pissed off because slavery is supposed to be over, mm-hmm. and they're saying, you know, it's how it's always been for us.
And they're denying having any association with the Sons of the Harpy.
Yeah.
Whereas we know that they are, through Varys's little whispers and whatnot, we know that they are directly connected to them, but they're denying it.
Yes. Yeah. And so Tyrion says, okay, we know that it's a hard change all at once. Right. So how about this? Slavery for 7 years, then mm-hmm. it's over.
Yeah.
It's He's like, 7 years to transition. Actually, I think that's reasonable in terms of what might keep us all from getting killed type of reasonable. Mm-hmm. But Missandei has a genuine and correct response, which is, well, it's not 7 years to the slaves.
Right.
Or she goes, well, it's not a short time to the slaves that mm-hmm. are, you know, it's still, you know, the injustice remains, dude. Mm-hmm. So we have this little moment. This is the little throne I was talking about. No, yeah. His feet up. It just... Oh, that's so cute.
They're used to being ruled by a person who makes no compromises, who says my way or the highway.
Yeah.
And now he's coming in, making decisions that the Khaleesi, whatever her titles are, she would never agree to in a million years.
Oh, wait, who would never? You think Tyrion would never agree?
No, Tyrion is making deals that Daenerys would never agree to.
To the seven-year thing, yeah.
Yeah.
He's basically ruling in her stead and saying that we're her advisor, we're not... But he's not taking over either. He's just
No. But all the reasons that Grey Worm and Missandei are loyal to Daenerys are completely blown out of the water by the proposals that Tyrion's making.
Yes.
They have to support him because Daenerys was the one who elected him to speak on her behalf.
Yeah.
But they completely disagree with what he's saying.
Yeah. So after this meeting, these guys are kind of hesitant. We're still getting up to the point where he gets them to agree. So this goes on. But the looks on Grey Worm's and Missandei's faces, they're like, what are you doing, man? You're giving up 7 years. That's crazy, you son of a bitch. And this guy's got weird eyes, and they drink this weird...
It's Corky Romano.
Corky Romano. Corky Romano. James, don't be funny. We don't have time for me to laugh, all right? So the... Tyrion's doing his thing, though. He's just working his politics and pissing him off. And he goes, bring in the girl. He doesn't say that. He rings a little bell. And the Hoochies come in and jump on their laps. And, you know, a little gift for a little going away present. And they all leave. Now we are in the throne room or the, you know, whatever they call this room. Where Dany has taken received mm-hmm. People to come ask her to, you know, they bring in their dead, burned up kids and stuff.
Yeah.
And these guys are all like former slaves. And they're right. And they go, what the hell, man? Wait. Oh, yeah. Tyrion's language isn't so good.
Yeah.
You wait so fat time. He's getting there. He's making progress. And she goes, maybe I should translate. We speak the common tongue. And so now they're speaking in English. And, you know, he's walking down. He's like, I'm not your king. I'm not your king. And so that's as he approaches, you know, he goes, this room was built to show power or something mm-hmm. like that, right?
Right.
Please correct me, by the way, James. I feel mm-hmm. like I'm getting every detail completely wrong. So jump in and tell me I'm full of it and fix the record here. So Tyrion, your turn to talk, James.
Well, they're basically saying that you are not our queen. You are not the one that makes decisions. We are not loyal to you. We do not trust you.
Yeah.
The people that we do trust are the people that are connected to us, the people who share experiences and our culture. We trust Grey Worms. We trust Missandei.
Yeah.
And so Tyrion tries to appeal to that argument they're making by looking at Grey Worm and saying, hey, back me up here, man.
Yeah.
You know, but Grey Worm does not want to back him up.
Yeah.
But so they're kind of forced.
Yes. Okay. Very good. Yeah. So, but these guys ask Grey Worm, like, what about you, dude? Mm-hmm. And, weren't you pissed off about this whole making deals with the slaver guys? And then Grey Worm, you know, he doesn't have experience doing this kind of shit.
No.
So he just falls in line, basically. Even though he's pissed, publicly he supports Tyrion. I'm not a soldier. I'm mm-hmm. I'm a soldier, not a politician. A just peace. That was his little mm-hmm. thing. I didn't get every, what do you call these things? Words. I didn't get every single one of those. So then he goes, what about you, Missandei? And she's like, I don't trust him, never will. And she's like, fuck you, Tyrion, you little bitch. Mm-hmm. But then she quotes, I think,
something that Tyrion said earlier in the episode.
Yes, we make peace with our enemies, not our friends. And so now they're walking off, and Grey Worm and Missandei are speaking up, though. They're finally letting their grievances
Grey Worm directly threatens him at this point.
What does he say?
He says something along the lines of, if you push me in a direction that's opposite to what the queen believes and to what I believe, then you become my enemy.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. If you become my enemy, that's my mm-hmm. Grey Worm impression. Okay, so they're like, Tyrion's like, yeah, motherfucker, you know, all right, whatever, it's all good. So there's some potential room for that to go south. That could be trouble there. Tyrion's doing his best, but like you said, he's out of his pay grade here. This is not his land. He doesn't know the ins and outs of the way these people are. Mm-hmm. So I think we're going to see some shit go down there. All right, now we're like, who's these guys walking? Okay, it's our boyfriend and the old dad who wants to be the boyfriend. Dario and Ser Jorah Mormont. They're wandering mm-hmm. up looking for Dany. We don't know where they are exactly. And they're talking about, he goes, oh, it must suck to be you old piece of shit.
Yeah, so he's antagonizing Jorah pretty badly, knowing that Jorah is in love and infatuated with Daenerys and basically reminding him that Daenerys has chosen him as a lover.
Yeah. Yeah, as a lover. Boy, I'd like to be somebody's lover one of these days, James. And so they're going up and getting a little tense, but they're not, like, they're kind of just sort of, you know, friendly fight. Why does he have a fishing lure here hanging off of his thing? All right, looks like one of those worm tail things.
It really does.
Put a little jig in the top of that fucker and go catch a walleye. So we see him pop his cute little head up like he's doing a...
a meerkat or prairie dog.
This is the meerkats of Wizards of Waverly Place. There he is! Whoa. Sorry, I'm so stupid. Now, what are they looking at? The horse town! This is the capital city, essentially, the main meeting place for all the Dothraki hordes.
Yeah, the whole time I was watching this scene, I was just picturing them laying there pointing at a giant green screen, because that's what they're doing.
I know, this is a flat wall.
Yeah,
this is totally... interesting though, these are the big horses James was disparaging of in a previous video. James goes, how'd they get the big horse sculptures?
Okay, look at the city and then look at the horses. James, whoever made those horses does not live in that city.
Obviously, James needs to believe in magic, unlike the rest of us. James has fucking bullet. Okay, all right. So they're going through and they're like, okay, here's what's going to happen. We can't go in. We're going to have to sneak in there. No weapons.
Yeah,
I thought he was taking a piss in this shot.
Well, Jorah, unlike most people, understands the Dothraki culture. He knows how to speak their language. He knows how to deal with them. He knows what they will execute him for and what they won't.
Yes, right. Yeah, and so he comes up with this plan to go in, and he goes, if we get caught, we'll just pretend we're traitors, not we're merchants or something. And so he's taking off his belt, and he's wrapping up his sword. He didn't seem to go to trouble to hide it. Maybe we missed that part. I assumed they'd bury it or, you know, put it under a pile of bushes or something. And so he convinces Dario to take off his sword and his weapons, and then he doesn't want to give up his favorite blade. We've seen him use this a lot. This comes off a bunch. Look at it. It's a sexy sword, and this woman is pooping out a giant spike. But in the scene where they approach, it might have been Meereen, and the champion comes out, I think season 3 or 4, and then the horse is charging at him, and he volunteers to fight, and he just, like, gets out his sword. He looks at Dany, and he just whips the knife and kills the horse and chops the guy's head off. And that's when Dany fell in love with him, because women love a man who kills horses. So He gives it a kissy kiss right on the little booty, right on the tramp stamp, which is a picture of a smaller knife. And Jorah's like, come on, dude. And now this moment, though, I hope I got a shot of it. Oh! Ah! So right before this shot is his gross stone arm. He's got the stone disease.
Yes.
Just like Stannis' daughter had, but she got lucky. She's rich. She had health care.
Grayscale, as they call
it. Grayscale. Thank you. Yeah. Yeah. So now his secret's out. But he handled it pretty well. I was a little surprised by Dario's response. He's like, all right. He goes, I didn't touch you with it. He goes, oh, okay.
Did you know, like, for the earlier readings, the grayscale girl, Stannis' daughter, I read online that they used a mixture that included cornflakes to create the effect on her face.
Are you making shit up right now, James?
If I'm reading wrong in the net, then I'm wrong, but that's what I said.
Be the weirdest lie to make up.
Yeah.
Wow, that's cool. So they use some sort of like pasty cornflake stuff. Yep. And oh, interesting. Wow, that's going to make breakfast hard for me tomorrow when I eat dried up cornflakes that I peel off my face. So he does, he pretends like he's going to give up the sword, and then he walks off and just stares into the camera. Oh, no, he goes, I'll take care of the knife. I don't want you to
touch
me.
Their whole plan was they're going to come in at night under the cover of darkness.
Yeah, so these are some dark shots here. So now we got a little caper. And so they're sneaking around. Going in, we got some banging happening, and what's his face, Dario, horny young man, as aren't we all, goes, I wish I was Dothraki, you know, it's like, geez, dude, chill, you've been banging the queen of the fucking world, and so now we got some punks, these are part of the Khalasar, now are these the same guys, it was a little too dark to tell, I think these are the same dudes that were talking about Dany's pussy hairs
I did recall that they looked familiar, I think that's what it is.
As storytellers making this show, it makes sense that they would make these dudes kind of like recurring sub-characters. So, but it could not be too. I think it is, though. So they're like, oh, this is not them speaking. This is
Jorah
speaking. Yeah. He's like, oh, we're merchants. And they're like, you're not merchants. He goes, oh, yeah, I sell wine. I'll give you the cask of the finest. He goes, you're not merchants. Not at all. And so the one guy runs. That's the right move. You don't stand there and fight. One of you goes, runs. The other one gets killed. So Dario takes off after the one guy. There he is. He's chasing him. While Jorah just gets the shit kicked out of him.
Yeah, he shows that he's the old man that people talk about.
He is showing his age a little. The reaction time just goes, James. You know, that's why Michael Jordan can only dunk on kids' basketball nets. It's kind of cut back from one to the other. Jorah's just getting, he's getting choked to death. Oh no, I won't be able to kiss my darling. But. Uh-oh, look here. He sprouted a horn, or a spike, to be more specific. More specifically, he was murdered by Dario, who had snuck his knife in.
And just screamed, it's a me, Dario.
It's a me, Dario.
So,
but this is the problem now, because there's a man with a stab wound in him, and you cannot have weapons inside the sacred city.
Yes, apparently this is a huge deal. So Dario takes matters into his own hands, and by matters I mean a large rock. And to cover up the stab wound, he just smashes the guy a bunch of times with the rock. Yeah. It's just right near in these shots. And Jorah's like, damn, fucking shit. I'm a knight, and that's fucked up, man. So, boom, Dany. Still got those huge caterpillars living on her forehead. Is hanging out with the old hags, and they're all like, oh, you dumb bitch. They're giving her grief. I mean, they're not threatening her or anything, but...
No.
You know, yes, the chick, what happened to you? Like, she's... Because all these are younger women, most of them. It was her call, found her running well, and then, you know, he got mad, and he broke her ribs. She was only 12 years old, so she got abused, and it's all fucked up. I mean, unless she was talking about, like, poor baby backs, you know, she had some TGIF Fridays take home. He snapped him in half, which just makes him it just turns him into rib tips. So when the calls meet for the Khalasar convention, the Khalarbazen tomorrow night, so that's when they're going to pick and do what they're going to decide to do with Dany. So she goes out to this chick, they kind of are bonding, and she's working her little charm and her little charisma. This is her charisma coming into play here. They're buddying up. She's telling her, what did she say? She say, we'll sneak out? What did she say to her? I will never leave until I rise from the smoke on the pyre. But they're setting it up that Dany is kind of like hatching plans and sort of trying to work what fulcrums she's got to make things happen.
I don't think she had much of a plan until she gets interrupted by...
The boyfriend and the wannabe boyfriend. They show up and he's right about to kill her. He goes, she'll tell her. She stops her. And they're like, we got to get out. We got to go now. And she goes, we'll die. He goes, well, that's the best chance we got. He was kind of like, yeah, we're good. I know. So she goes, no, I got another idea, okay? And you, you're going to be loyal, okay? You little bitch, you're be my buddy, now.
And she calls her Khaleesi, which is interesting to hear her call someone else that.
Oh, yeah. Is that, that's right.
Yeah, because they're all Khaleesis.
They're all Khaleesis. It's a little Khaleesi fest. Mm-hmm. Wow. Good catch. So now Marjorie is still a prisoner with this fucking bitch. I hate this woman so... Oh, she makes me angry. James, do you have a similar response?
She's just doing her job. She just wants to make a living.
She's the top female leader of these fuckers.
She didn't spend 6 years in Confess College to Confess be disrespected college. The way she's being...
Miss Confess. Hey, by the way, nice belly chain, okay? Mm. What are you, a weird porno actress? Okay, so she walks in and Marjorie, we're wondering, like, you made a prediction here. You thought...
I think what's probably going to happen is that Marjorie is going to be killed when the prisoners are liberated in Jaime and Cersei's massive attack on the faith militant
people. So James just goes, yeah, whoa, I feel like Cersei and Jaime are going to come crashing down.
I can definitely...
And use it as an excuse to kill Marjorie.
I can absolutely see Cersei standing in a cell looking down at Marjorie saying something like, such a pity that you didn't survive the rescue attempt or something like that, and then killing her. Because she is a threat. She wants to control and manipulate her son. She wants to be back in a position of power.
Yeah.
She wants to be the queen regent once more. She does not want to have...
Yeah, we all understand. Yeah, she hates Marjorie.
Yeah, she does not want anything to do with Marjorie. Yeah. She wants her dead.
She empowered the Faith Militant specifically to take Marjorie out.
Yes, yeah. And so she doesn't forget her goals.
I think that's a good prediction, but I was like, she's not going to do it. It's not going to happen this episode. That would be really fast.
No, not this episode. Yeah, I didn't think that either.
Yeah. She would look at her and say, Tommen's up. So... fortunately, though, this wench, God, she makes me angry. She's probably just a nice actress. Mm-hmm. She just is bringing her in. And so now she's got a bright light and she's talking to the old fucker. The other guy I hate. I hate these two. These two, this lady here and this son of a bitch here, they need to go have themselves some evil pope sex and get it out of their system.
So to make a long scene short, basically what happens is that he talks to her, tells her this drawn out story about six-sided
dice
pendant
dungeon. No, I don't know what you're talking about.
The story.
Why he's not wearing shoes?
No. Okay. Yeah. No.
What are you talking about?
What am I trying to talk? The story that he's telling her about. He gets halfway through the story and she starts filling it in and he goes, "Oh, so you've heard of the six-sided?"
Wow.
That was the story he was telling her.
Really?
Yes.
I thought he told her a story about how he and his buddies had an orgy, and that's when he decided to quit being such a fucking, and turn to a religion.
That came afterwards.
Oh, okay. Wow, I must have tuned out. All right, well, I believe you. I don't disagree. You're not making anything up. So, by the way, this is very peace. He just has a really strong stream.
I did not notice that.
So something about six-sided. James got the iPad out here. He'll look it up. So then he tells her this whole thing about how I was a cobbler. I used to spend hours and hours and hours making shoes, wasting time, making shoes for rich people because I wanted to live like they did, and I was a fucking asshole. I was a merchant. I'd live like they did. And then the camera really slowly zoomed in on him. He's like, well, we had a big party. We had girls. We were switching the girls. We were getting drunk. Everybody, he goes, I woke up at 4 a.m. I don't know what time. And everybody was fucked up and sleeping with their clothes, their piles of their fancy clothes. He goes, you probably wore some rich clothes, didn't you? And she's like, yeah. And then he goes, I went and fed the homeless people because I felt like a piece of shit because I just had a big old sex romp with my buddies. I don't know if they actually did it, but that's the presumption when the clothes come off. Did you find anything?
No, I did not.
All right. Look at that. So look at him. Ooh. This is him remembering one of those girls. At least that's the face I make. So she's like, Jesus, this guy's fucking crazy. He gave up fun, awesome nights. Like, this guy described a great time, and then he went and became a... Why don't you just keep having orgies and then go feed the homeless people and be a nice guy during the day? You don't have... They're not mutually exclusive. You're allowed to have orgasms and, oatmeal bars. All right, well, James, what do you got?
I just wanted to bring up the person who commented on the video last time, the Snow in Winterfell. I guarantee he's going to help us out on that
one. We have some great listeners already that are really filling in some of the gaps. So don't worry. We're good. Look in our comments if you want to see the gaps filled in. Because, James, there's so much to keep track of. I believe you, dude, by the way. I don't want, don't be sleep talking about that shit later. So she's like, okay. And then he reaches out. This guy's kind of pulling a similar move as he did on Tommen, although he thinks he is. So he, you know, she reaches up and takes his hand, and they're like, and then he goes, okay, let's break in, have you see your brother.
Well, what's happening is that he can't break them.
Yeah.
He's not getting any leeway with them. They're not confessing. So he sends her in an attempt to break him further.
Right. To try, yes. Wow, yeah. So, but what does he being broken even mean? Like he...
To confess. Come clean.
Okay, sure. So he hasn't? He's very hurt.
Well, that's the thing. Here. I don't think they realize just how close to the edge he is. And by sending her in, he's actually reverting the progress he's already made. Sends her in trying to get her to make him crack to give in, not realizing he was going to do it anyway. So and now she's emboldened him.
He sort of deputized her to try to talk him into giving up. But he might be emboldened, or... Sometimes this is something like a way of torturing you by giving you a little bit of hope and then pulling it back away from you. That's something really fucked up. People do that kind of thing. Believe me, I had a phase. No, I'm just joking. I don't know what I'm talking about. So he's shit, man. And they've been pretty rough on him. He's crying and he's all worked up and she starts crying and it's kind of sad though. I feel bad for them. These people are rich and their hair's all fucked up. So now we got Cersei, speaking of fucked up hair. And she walks in and she listens for a moment to Pycelle talking to Tommen, pisses her off. So she marches in and goes, hey, why are you talking to my buddy here? Okay, get out of here, Tommen. James, quit looking it up.
I must know.
James, you're on your iPad swiping through you're at the pap smear appointment. So, okay. So Tommen stands up and he goes, like, hey, he's gave my counsel. I'm a nice boy. And she closes the door and says, I got some words for this little kid. But Tommen brings up words that he ideas. People keep texting me. What the fuck? I get like one text a week. Tommen brings up shit that the High Septon had told him. So he's been influenced.
Right.
Is that cool?
And one thing to bring up really quickly, you see, uh-huh. Remember we talked about before that she is wearing the necklace, if you go back two frames?
Yeah.
That belonged to her daughter.
Uh-huh.
And you also notice that she has been wearing, ever since Joffrey died, she's also been wearing Joffrey's ring.
Yep.
So I wonder when he gets killed, in whatever way he gets killed, what will she wear of his?
She'll wear his diapers.
Nice.
So what does she tell him, though, here? She tells him, she's kind of like, this guy fucked our family, man. What the hell? Why are you giving me... What does he say that the High Septon had told him, though?
Something to the degree of to stand down, to attack.
And not to escalate further.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that was the same thing Maester Pycelle was trying to reiterate, saying that no good will come from conflict.
Yeah. Right. And she's like, oh, my little son, you have no idea. This shit is going
to
get...
Yeah, look what they did to your mother.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. She, totally. Because now they both have the same haircut.
Yeah.
Yeah, look at him. She would look just as silly as he does wearing the crown. So that was more or less the gist of this scene. I don't think... Yeah, there's the ring.
Yep.
That's Joffrey's ring, huh?
Yes, I believe that is Joffrey's ring.
I remember Joffrey wearing a slightly thinner... That he would spin it around. He would, he would finger it constantly. Thumb it, I guess, is a better term. I think you might be right, though. Let's get it. Yeah, cool. Good catch. James has a sharp eye, I gotta say. And an even sharper dresser. Right. Holds lots of clothes. So then they go to the small council meeting. Oh, we gotta confirm this. Is this guy Kevin Lannister or not? I thought this was Kevin Lannister. Was I wrong? Because I thought I heard them reference that he was this lady's husband or something. Or uncle. I don't know. We're confusing everybody. People are probably getting enraged. What a cute couple, by the way. So handsome. No wonder they had such good-looking kids. Okay. So it is Kevin Lannister. Okay, cool. K-E-V-A-N.
Yeah, just know I typed in K-E-V-I-N.
Yeah, well, you would. Why would you type Kevin with an A? It's great. That's the only thing crazier is Kevin with a Y. So, James, this whole conversation is about what to do next, right? About Margaery, really, because this old lady is worried. It's her granddaughter,
right?
The Queen of Thorns. So, what do they say?
She basically tries to antagonize, not to antagonize, but to force them into action.
Cersei tries to force them in.
Yes, to try and get them to attack the Faith Militant, to take back King's Landing at the cost of much bloodshed, which, and I believe that she says something like, it's, you know, lives will be lost, but better theirs than ours.
Yeah, right. No, yeah. I'm thinking, what?
Well, she basically tells her that your daughter, or your granddaughter, I should say, I got that wrong last time, but
yeah,
your granddaughter is poised to confess, to go through the same thing I did, to shame herself in front of thousands.
Yeah. And do the Walk of Atonement.
Yes, and the grandmother, whose name is Olena?
Elena, yeah.
Basically saying, you know, that cannot happen, that must not happen.
Yeah, so they're determined to prevent that from happening. Yeah, but she's telling her that to incentivize them to call up their army, though, right?
Yes, because the Tyrells have a massive army that can come in and get this done.
The second biggest army in the land, they said, I think.
Right, yeah. But Kevin Lannister has been ordered by the king to stand down, not to attack, not to pursue.
Yeah.
And he was saying, like, well, then the Tyrells will come in and do it, and you will have you won't break any oath in by standing down. You'll be following orders to a T.
Yeah.
And by the time that the king has any reason to, you know, to do anything, it'll be over.
Right.
So that's the best answer to the problem.
Yeah. Yeah. And I want to see those Faith Militant fuck faces get what they got coming to them, which is having their hair cut off.
But the problem is, isn't the lead, not the lead Faith Militant, but the one that we first saw come in with the symbol on the forehead, the Lannister?
Yeah, one
is
of
that
them...
not his son, Kevin Lannister's son?
Oh, yeah, that's the son that they referred. That's why I got confused. Okay, mm-hmm. Thank you. Ah, Jesus, it all just became clear. I was so confused because he said his son, and I thought his son, they went Lancel.
No.
The knight, the gay guy.
No.
That's all fucked up in jail. That, okay, no. Well, his son is actually the boy who was used to bang Cersei, and right, also was Robert Baratheon's squire. He goes, mm-hmm, go get the breastplate stretcher. Yes. That was him too.
So he wants to free his son as well.
Yeah. So his son has been not captured, but he's been brainwashed, and he's part of them. And so that's his personal struggle. Mm-hmm. Okay. That's why I was thinking, like, maybe he's a Tyrell, not the Lannister. That's why I was, but it doesn't mm-hmm make sense that the hand. That's why. Because okay. All right. Good. We're back. We're back, baby. All right. So thank you, James. You helped me understand, mm-hmm, and they're having this moment. A little bit more friendly than in previous shots, mm-hmm, with these two. So, uh-oh, it's cloudy. Arya!
No.
Theon! I know, we both go, hey, wait, is it Arya? We weren't sure, but we should have seen the fucking city.
Pike.
Yeah, the Pike Towers, or the tall rock towers. It's Theon, he's home!
Yeah, so he's coming back home, his father's dead.
Yeah. His dick is gone.
And they're holding, what did you call this, the King's Moot.
Yeah,
so they're going to choose a new King of Pike.
Yeah, yeah. So that's on its way. Of course, his sister, she is the de facto leader. She's still got the Kraken, fire crackling Kraken.
And her name is Yara,
I think, something
and
like
she
that.
And she basically accuses him of coming back at a time that is ripe for him to take the throne. And she's not very happy about it. She lost men trying to rescue him. She saw how he was beaten down, broken apart.
Yep. She burned his dick in the fire like a tiny little log. Yeah. By the way, great name for a pirate.
Yar. Yeah. So she's got no love for him at this point.
Yeah, it was kind of weird. She's actually been the, like you said, she went to try to rescue. She has a soft side for mm-hmm Theon, like when her father didn't. But she's assumed this like hardened asshole mm-hmm disposition that her dad had.
Right, because she thinks he's coming to take something from her that she believes is rightfully hers.
Yeah. By the way, no bigger douchebag move in the world than staring at a fire and then someone enters the room and you just start talking to them without moving your head. I hate that. If anybody ever does that to me, I'm going to stab you in the back of the head, even if it's my own dad. By the way, that's how my dad died. So she turns her head. And finally, and I think she kind of sees how fucked up he is, but she doesn't care. She's like, you piece of shit. I tried to rescue you. Look at you now, you dickless little piece of crap showing up here to be a little bitch.
Yeah, she asks, how did you get here? Did he let you free? And he goes, no, I escaped.
Yeah, I escaped. I'm Theon. My confidence is gone. I'm on Tinder. And
swipe right, please.
Yeah, please swipe right, because I can't. It's hard. It's very hard being no dick. I've got to find somebody who's very patient and understanding. So this was kind of a nasty scene, though. She was really hard on him.
But she softens up when he tells her, with tears coming out of his eyes, that all he wants is to see her rule the Iron Islands.
Yeah. What and do you want, Theon? And he goes, I want to help. I want you to rule, and I'll help.
Yeah. And after that, she was like, okay, cool.
Cut to. Okay, James, what's the symbolism of him chopping up an apple?
Well, his house banners is the flayed man.
Yeah.
So peeling the skin off an apple is pretty much flaying something.
It should be the flayed apple.
Yeah.
Maybe when the house finally cools their fucking jets with the torture, mm-hmm, they'll just be like, hey, we have fruit, but we used to cut people apart. So, okay, he's chopping apart an apple. Sinister cutting up an apple. Osha comes in. Mm-hmm. Short for Occupational Safety Health Administration.
Yeah.
I like her a lot. I think she's probably super hot in real life, mm-hmm. you know, here around Los Angeles where we live. Maybe I'll see her down at the In-N-Out one of these days, James. Are you kidding? I can't afford In-N-Out rallies. So they have this little thing, and she's pulling, which wisely I should would say, although kind of sad, but not sad because it's her, but just that she can use her sexuality to try to get what she wants or to try to manipulate and control.
Which it's she's a done tool. Before.
She did it on Theon when he had captured Winterfell, and but then she used it to, I think, yeah, she slept with him. She was naked. You guys saw her body, by the way. Wink, wink. And then she helped Bran and Rickon escape. That was before they got out of Winterfell.
Right, but she doesn't know who she's matched up with this time.
Yeah. So this scene goes on, takes his time. He's like, hello, I'm a crazy fucking
guy.
And
did you know that he said that he was inspired to play Ramsay by watching Heath Ledger as the Joker?
Oh, this actor said that? Mm-hmm. Wow. Jeez, I hope he's inspired to take too many drugs and not wake up one day. No, I'm just joking. He's a good actor. It's like that thing people hate, the Joffrey, the actor.
Yeah.
Like, that dude gets shit because he's such an evil actor.
Yeah.
He kind of hates acting. You ever
see? He's trying to study Hebrew now, I think.
Yeah, he gave this big treat. He's too intelligent to be, like, a famous person. Meaning, like, it drove him crazy. He's like, fuck this shit. It's all bullshit. Okay, that's all. Google Joffrey actor, and you'll find a bunch of weird stuff.
Yeah, he actually smoked a pipe and read Kierkegaard on set.
Oh, wow. Jesus.
I've been reading a lot of trivia lately.
I've hung out with dudes that smoke pipes. Fucking douchebags. All right, so this happens. She kind of comes up here, scoot up the shirt, puts it down.
Yeah, the whole while she's got her other eye open, reaching towards the apple knife.
On this little apple knife. If it's sharp enough for an apple, it's sharp enough for a dude's mouth or throat or head or chest. And so look at her. There she is.
Yeah, but everyone watching this scene has to know that this is not how Ramsay dies.
Yeah.
It's not going to be this easy.
It occurred to me, wow, it is Game of Thrones. Maybe he's going to die now. But no, this dude's ending has got to be much...
painfully obvious what was going to happen.
Yeah, so, oh, she puts her hand down his pants. He's like, oh, I like that even more. Oh. Which is, by the way, the only thing he's ever said that I agree with. And she reaches, and she's really... you can tell someone's reaching. And she wasn't being... At a certain point, it stopped being subtle. And she makes the move because she senses that he senses it. She goes for it. No! Oh!
Now, he had another knife in his other hand.
Yeah, look, he must be reaching for it in this shot here.
Yeah.
Whack! 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 Okay, sorry, James. I hit a feedback loop. Oh, man, that sucked. I liked her a lot. Mm-hmm. She was all right. Yep. Nope, that's that sad moment before you die, but you're about to die, where you look at the person who killed you and you go, oh, man. You're the last. Delete my porn. So boom, didn't work out,
and he immediately just wipes off the knife and goes back to cutting his apple
as she dies on her thing.
Amazing.
Which is very, very in character. A little too on the nose, to be honest here, but yeah, there he is wiping the knife
and then just eats.
Took a small cut. Okay, another flayed thing. You know, these are the guys riding in. What was that? What's going on? Oh, this is a messenger. Wait, what's happening here, James?
He brings a message from the Boltons. And remember, this is the one that Jon Snow was reading at the table.
Yes. Okay, so because I was like, Castle Black and Sansa. And I was, okay, my streams got crossed. Yeah, so we get a letter in the mail. Oh, first, there's a little bit kind of funny where Brienne is, like, grossed out by the way these savages are eating. You know, they're just sort of, like, digging into these disgusting things. Mm-hmm. Sansa's a little bit too, but she's kind of like, this is better than, you know, better than whatever else I've been. Brienne is just making these faces. Oh, yeah, this guy here. I would never add anybody other than a wildling. He didn't say that, but that's what he's thinking. And his peepee's hard, and he is hiding it. Look at him. He has bedroom eyes for her, and she is like, fuck, I don't think so. But she's not a very sexual person. But James, I got a little secret for you. We're all sexual creatures. I bet you maybe a little part of her is like, you know what? Big man, big woman, we could probably make this happen. Come on. You know, this is a... I sense some love in here, James. And not bad kind, the good kind.
I think she's got a thing for 1-1.
Yeah, 1-1. Yeah, the giant. She's going to jump on the giant. That's hilarious. Brienne, wife, boner. So Ed's like, oh boy. He's like, I'm sleeping with my earplugs on tonight. So they're having a little couple moments. Okay, hey, I got a letter. He's like, Lord Commander, a letter for you. He goes, I'm not the Lord Commander anymore.
You've got mail.
Yeah. Ding, ding. And so, ICQ, remember that shit?
Mm-hmm. Oh, so, yeah.
he gets to him anyway. He opens it. He goes, okay. Oh, they showed the little stamp to the flayed. He reads this whole thing. He kept saying, come and see, three times. He kind of ended certain paragraphs that way. You want to give the gist of the letter?
Yeah, he says that, you know, Winterfell belongs to me. You cannot take it back. If you want to try and take it back, come and get it. Also, I have your brother Rickon in my dungeon.
Yes.
I am going to do terrible things. And when I take your sister back, I'm going to do terrible things to her as well.
Yeah.
I'm going to pluck John out your eyes. John
stops reading it, though.
Yeah.
Because he's like, it just goes on and on.
Yeah, because he says terrible things about Sansa specifically and about him.
That he didn't want to say
out loud.
I'm going to do terrible things to her. Yeah. So she takes it and reads it. He's like, damn, this is fucked up.
So now he knows that his technically not really his brother, but kind of his brother.
Yeah, his brother, not even technically. They're blood related. They're same dad.
I don't believe that to be true, but
that's another story. Oh, Mr. Theory here. Wait, you don't think Eddard Stark is... You don't think Ned's the dad?
No, I don't.
Wow. I haven't heard... The only theories I've come across, and only vaguely, was that we don't know who the mom is, so the mom might be someone of, like, known status.
I think Ned is more of an... You know, he's got more integrity than that. He wouldn't have done that to Cat Stark.
So he took someone else's baby that might have been orphaned?
Yes.
Like he's a Baratheon?
I believe that he is lying to cover up.
Wow. Holy shit. My head's melting.
But anyway, he's... Okay. Yeah.
All right. That's a whole side note there. Yeah. Wow.
This is everything they needed to know to convince the Salt
and
Winterfell.
Any hesitation John had, he cannot let this stand. He can't let Rickon be fucked with, and he can't let this threat to Sansa go.
So Sansa is saying, you know...
Yeah.
You have to come and march. You have the wildling army on your side.
And hey, Sansa, how many army? He goes, I overheard them say 5,000. Mm-hmm. And he goes, how many do you have? And he goes, 2,000 wildlings. Mm-hmm. You know, this dude's really loyal. And the wildlings think he's a god.
Mm-hmm.
So
is a god.
That's what I mean. Yep. Yeah, John. So it's not much of a stretch for him to get their loyalty. Plus, they kind of need something to do.
Yeah.
One of the issues in the books, pardon me, is they can't... And the show is like they have to. How do we feed all these wildlings? What do we do with them here at Castle Black? We're so understaffed and stuff. So, okay, this is crazy. So now she goes at it again with him, makes her pitch, rightfully so. And he's like, yeah, of course, all right. He shakes his head. He goes, yes. Okay, so bam, we go to Danny. Let's get through this quickly. We're trying to keep these short, it's so hard. Okay, so this is the Keza Vazalaho, where all the calls gather in this pit, this big meeting room, which we've seen before.
Yep, this is where she ate the horse heart, and this is where a lot of stuff went
down. They're deciding what to do with her. Best outcome is they let her live with the old hags and young hags. Worst outcome is they all fucking rape her and stuff, and that's horrifying. So this is not a good scene for Dani, but she's got something up. Mm-hmm. She told her boyfriend and the old man that they're gonna chill out for a while. Mm-hmm. Don't go killing. So these guys are all like, oh, I want to eat your pussy and it's gonna be horrible. God, man. Oh, and the one guy goes, well, the rich men are offering 10,000 horses for this girl. They really want her. And the main cow goes, one pink little girl. She could probably tan, you know, get her a little bit brown. And this dude's like, I don't give a fuck about those people. I'll go take their horses.
Right.
You know, super confident. He's like the top cow.
His eyes are really close together.
Yeah, he's got it's whatever video game creation system created his tool, he should have spread those eyes apart a little more. To be fair, James, my balls are really close together. So, promise to kill the man in their iron suits and tear down their stone house. He's talking about the old call, right? Drogo.
Yes.
Yeah. So, they had a bunch of words back and forth. We didn't need to go, you are a small man.
She really provokes him here.
Yeah, I like this. This is my favorite Danny. This is the one that goes, okay, it's time for... And James just did the Z snaps.
Yeah.
All right. Sassy Madonna Cher... Beyonce comes out here and goes, I am gonna, you guys are all little bitches, and I'm gonna lead this place.
I was struggling to figure out how she was gonna get out of this. Is she gonna kick the door down and there's gonna be a dragon there? But it's like, she doesn't know where the dragon is, and she only has Jorah and Dario. How are they gonna do anything?
Right. My guess was that Drogo was gonna burn the hut down. That's what I was thinking. I was like, okay, well, now would be a good time for the pet dragon to show up and murder everybody, and she'll be fine. That didn't happen, though. So they all laugh at her when she tells her she's going to take over, and she just is like, okay, all right. And then it turns bad. They made up their mind, we're going to gang rape you, and then we're all going to my blood riders will, and then and he goes, I might even let my horses if you're not dead. So they said that, yeah, they said some shitty stuff, and she is unfazed. You crazy cunt. This is going to be a meme. It probably already is. So she puts her hand in the fire, right? She's holding it. You mm-hmm. see her holding it there. Oh, she got back her pearl ring there, by the way.
Check oh, that's that interesting.
Yeah.
I didn't notice that.
Me neither. And what does she do? She pushes it over.
So I've got a couple of problems with this.
Okay.
First of all, the floor is clearly dirt. Why is the fire spreading so quickly across dirt?
Because gas and oil burns, James. Next question.
Okay, second of all, why in the world would they just cower and flee to the side? You'd think that they would just charge her, kill her really quickly, and then bust through the, you know, the door.
Well, have you ever had fire thrown at you? It's a very alarming moment.
These are Dothraki. They should not be terrified of a little flame.
True, but they're terrified of a big flame. Hence the big flame.
I don't recall her going in there and, you know, dousing the floor in gasoline. That's all.
Well, okay, so I don't actually disagree with you much. It goes crazy, though, and she starts pushing over these things. These four, they call them braziers, mm-hmm. right? Which I can make all kinds of jokes of. I love a good brazier. They all just sort of just get burned up. They're running around. The wood, the walls start burning, which makes mm-hmm. sense. This place is dusty and dry. So it's locked. Obviously, these dudes locked it, I think. I think that's the move.
Oh, yeah, here. Yeah. They killed the guard outside and
so, barricaded. So she's just taking a bath in the fire pit. No. But she's just standing there, super confident, while the whole place burns down. And the guys are running around. They get trapped by the door. I agree. Like, these things... First of all, they would be like wood embers, most likely, or perhaps a coal type. And if you pushed one over, it would make a big mess, and the fire would kind of spread around. But unless there was extra fuel, it's not going to really, you know. But you know what? Maybe she's got some extra magic shit happening too. Mm-hmm. She is the she is inflammable, or non-flammable. Well, I don't know what the right word is.
Inflammable means she can burn.
No, flammable and inflammable mean the same thing. Yeah, yes. I know. Fucking.
She's fire retardant.
She's fire retardant. They're flammable and inflammable.
Yes.
And so he goes, oh, fuck, I shouldn't have been such an asshole. And she takes the final push, and the whole place goes up. Gathering of everybody.
I would have expected her to be standing there just like reveling in her awesomeness, saying, I cannot be burned. Then a giant, you know, wooden...
Oh, like a beam knocks on the head.
Falls on her head.
Yeah, like she just has very high fire resistance.
Yeah, because that's the thing. It's like, okay, I get it, you can't be burned, but what about smoke inhalation? Well, I mean, that's what kills you.
Yeah, but if you're a magical queen who...
She's not even coughing.
If you're the mother of dragons and your magic is fire, I think that there's smoke is close enough to fire to be like also within the realm of that power.
Shouldn't she have like a really gravelly voice?
I would say
voice?
That she should be like maybe frost damage or lightning damage or something, some other kind of magic damage. These are like video game jokes we're making, everybody, and they're not even that funny. So the whole place goes up, but what's most important here is that everybody watches it happen.
Right, and this is a throwback to when she first became powerful and revered to the Dothraki, where she went on to the funeral pyre of Khal Drogo and emerged unburnt, holding the dragon eggs that has since hatched into draglings on her shoulders.
Yes.
If that's even a word.
No, yeah, totally. This is exactly what that is.
So she knew this would work.
As the guy points out, one of the creators of the show after the credits or whatever, goes like, when that happened, nobody really saw it except for a few people. And this time, the entire Dothraki population or, you know, the center city is all seeing it. By the way, Alice in Chains is here to watch it too. So whatever that guy's name is. What, Alice Cooper. Alice Cooper. Is that? Yeah. So there. So she comes walking out. Sorry, everybody. I put black boxes on the nips. You know,
I don't see any black boxes.
James, I got to edit this afterwards. By the way, you want to see nips? We got the Google. Okay, go Google nips. Delicious candy. So she comes. But that was we had talked about in a previous.
I thought she was done with the nudity.
Yeah, we thought that this actress had said no more titty showing. So maybe it's a stunt.
We can do a before and after comparison. We can have two black boxes over here and two black boxes over there. See if they look the same.
So she comes walking out like the fucking Terminator, you know, the metal robot, the evil Terminator. And boom, they all see it. And they go, what the fuck? Our whole world is crazy, man. Because she just destroyed the power structure of their whole civilization. And what do you do when someone's really powerful? Well, you worship them. You get down on your fucking hands and knees, and you start giving them 10% of your money. and let them diddle your kids. Wait, that's a different religion. So, what? Would you have reacted like this, or would you have run?
I probably would have gotten out of there.
She does have nice boobs, though. So, and to be fair, that's probably what they—that's what I would have been worshiping. So, boom, birthing. This is another. So, my whole theory about the first season is that it's a birthing story for her, in a way, where it's like, you know, she is doesn't know her destiny, and then she reaches that point where she emerges from the fire clean.
The problem, yeah. What's she going to call herself now? What new title is she going to bestow upon herself? The Unburned 2?
Yeah.
Mega Unburned?
Yeah. No, the
Twice Unburned?
No, she's going to call herself the Queen, the Smokestack.
Burner of Cows?
Stack Smoke.
Yeah.
For the booby joke. That's a booby joke, James. Yeah. So, okay, there's Alice Cooper looking on going, fuck. And then she's like, these guys come walking up. You know, they're not as, they want to get closer because it's, they didn't pay for these tickets, but they're gonna get down to the front row anyway. And shit, they're all into it. They are into it. Speaking of into it, I am into it. I got to edit. It's putting those little black boxes on. Such a bitch, James. So there they go. Boom. What'd you think? Give me your analysis. I think we're way over an hour.
I thought it was kind of a slow episode in terms of action, but I think it was setting up the pieces to lead us into a very, very exciting action-packed assault on Winterfell in the next coming episodes.
Okay, you think the assault will happen in the next episode?
I think so, and I also wanted to comment on why do you think it's called the Book of the Stranger?
The Book of the Stranger, or Book of the Stranger. So you, the Stranger is the one of the seven.
One of the seven gods.
Yeah, and he represents the unknown
and death.
And death. And you said Sam sang a song to the baby, to Gilly's baby, and
yes.
Then he mentioned six.
Well, it's called I think the song is called the Seven Gods or something like that.
Yeah.
But the song only references six gods.
Uh-huh.
And Gilly says, "Well, why? If the song is called the Seven, why do you only reference six?" And he says, "No one sings for the Stranger."
Okay, so they don't like talking about it, basically.
No. And he's depicted as like a grim reaper looking skeletal figure.
Yeah, well, this is like the English classroom discussion bullshit, so all of this is garbage. But see, she just showed up, she's a stranger, they don't know her, and she brought death to them, but in death she is reborn in a way.
Mm-hmm.
And also she'll be a massive threat now. She can head back and take over the slave towns and, you know, set some shit right now that she's got the Dothraki horde.
Mm-hmm.
Even the knights are scared. Like everybody knows the Dothraki horde is terrifying.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's a scene in one of the previous episodes where very early where Robert Baratheon is afraid of Dany, you know, when he tries to have her killed. And he goes, a girl with a Dothraki horde at her back. She'll kill us all.
No, I would personally go for an army of eunuchs.
Eunuchs.
You never know what they have up their sleeve.
Well, she has that too.
Yeah.
I'll tell you what they don't have up their sleeve.
No.
Definitely not up their pants.
Speaking of trivia before, do you know that Varys was gotten in trouble with the producers in multiple cases? Not Varys, but
the actor
who plays him.
Because
he would actually hide snacks in his sleeves because he's always walking around with his arms up there and would eat between the takes.
That explains why Skittles keeps falling out
yeah,
of his,
that,
out of
that
his
would
cloak.
Be a, yeah.
Okay, so the stranger there for Dany, there's that. I don't know what else it means, the Book of the Stranger. I mean, there's a lot of death. We lost Osha. That's sad. She should have followed the office safety rules.
Yeah, I think it's a precursor to what's going to happen in Winterfell. That the precursor to death.
Yeah. Wait, what? This, what is?
The title of this episode was setting everything up for the assault on Winterfell.
Okay.
And the Stranger being the embodiment of death, this is leading the Book of the Stranger.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
The assault on Winterfell.
For sure. Yeah, well, there's a lot of death on its way. We haven't seen too much this season, really.
Right.
So, yeah, man, it's, who knows? Who knows? We'll see what happens. Littlefinger, you know, it's going to be, they're going to, Littlefinger's going to come up with the veil.
He's going to unite with his big brother, Big Toe.
Yeah. Big Toe and Littlefinger. And, and that long lost sister, Audi Belly Button.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, she'll be on the way, too. And, yeah, will the Greyjoys get involved in that war with Winterfell? I don't know. We'll see.
Do you think?
Because we've got the Umbers and the Karstarks and the other various houses. But once they see Jon, Jon and Sansa, are they going to remain loyal? The Karstarks have definitely thrown their towel in with the Boltons. So they're pretty much,
Do you think that the Littlefinger's Vale army is going to assist or attack against the Wildling army led by Jon Snow when they both converge at Winterfell?
No, I think they're going to attack Winterfell. I think they're going to be part of returning Winterfell to the Starks. I mean, who knows? Littlefinger always has something up his sleeve.
Right.
Because the Lannisters aren't really going to be involved with that much unless they see it as an opportunity, because they're kind of distracted with this internal power struggle with the Tyrells, in preparation for whatever's going to happen with the Faith Militant.
Right. And does Littlefinger want to be Warden of the North?
That was his original plan, wasn't it? Wasn't that kind of like what he was?
Well, he currently is. He became Lord of Harrenhal, was it?
Yeah.
And now he always wants more than he has.
He was yes, exactly. Mm-hmm. He was promised, I think, Warden of the North from Tywin and mm-hmm. Harrenhal. Like, he was told he could. I don't know. It gets confused. There's mm-hmm. a little, and whenever somebody dies, all the promises die with them. So it all has to kind of get jumbled around.
And what's going to happen when Jon Snow and the Wildlings leave Castle Black, and then the White Walkers come against Castle Black?
That's going to. I've said that in a previous mm-hmm. one where that seems to me to be where they're all going to have to go. Oh shit, we've mm-hmm. got to all fight. It's like if Earth got invaded by aliens, we'd stop fighting amongst ourselves and just start all fighting aliens. Yeah. You know, so that's kind of we'll see what happens with that. And Arya is somewhere out there. We didn't see her this episode, so she'll probably come by and probably start putting on different masks and chopping people's dicks off and stabbing people in the eyes and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. So that'll be fun. Mm-hmm. That's exciting. Anything else to say?
Someone at work told me that they had a theory about who the Sons of the Harpies were, and I really do not think this is true.
Give it.
He thinks that the Sons of the Harpies are led by Viserys. Is that his name? The brother of
The guy who died?
Yeah, who got the golden crown. He's like, well, think about it, man. The golden crown, the golden faceplate is symbolic of him. He didn't die. He can't be burned. A dragon can't be burned. He's a Targaryen.
Do you work at a lead paint factory?
I was wondering, because I was like, dude, he's pretty much dead. And I pulled up a picture of him with his face all burned and bloody with a golden crown on. I was like, yeah, he's dead. He's gone. He's like, no, I think he's sick of something.
And the whole point is that he's not the dragon he claims to be because he's susceptible to heat and fire.
Right. She even looks at him and goes, he was no true dragon.
Yeah. Nah, yeah.
They made a point to say that.
Yeah. Now, that guy's just a top-notch dumb shit.
I wouldn't. Well, he's a nice guy.
Yeah. Stupid people can be nice.
No.
I just don't think that theory makes sense.
Yeah, I don't really buy into that theory.
And he's a stupid. No, I'm joking. I shouldn't be like that. So, yeah, that's obviously not true. I don't know. I want to talk more. I could always keep talking, but we want to keep. It's probably well over an hour as it is anyway. So, all right.
Just turn it on double speed so we'll sound,
Just speed. I actually do edit that way. So, thanks, guys. That's all for this one. Book of the Stranger. We hope you enjoyed our talk, our discussion, our recap. We're really glad that people have been responding and weighing in, and we actually get to finally see some numbers on our channel, which is fucking weird. I work so hard on this goddamn video game shit, and then no one watches anything. I'm grateful is what I'm saying, and it's fun. It's so we're having fun doing these. If you're enjoying it, like and subscribe and be part of our community. You don't have to say anything, by liking and subscribing, you're letting us know that our work is our efforts are appreciated, and we do it for you as much as for us. All right, James, you good?
I'm good.
Okay, cool. We can stop holding hands.
Until next Sunday.
Bye.
He tickles.